give you guys some instructions as well. I'm going to start with the instructions for you guys. I want to encourage everybody to, and you could do this even like now, but make sure you go in the back. If you're going to have questions, there are on the table in the back are green sheets of paper. We're reusing paper, so don't have to worry about filling out your name and all that. That's on the one side. But on the green, if you could just write who your question's to and also what your question is, when after the break, we're going to collect all of those questions. That's going to be the way for you guys to engage with the debaters up here on what the topics that they have are. And so, hey, Frank, if you could just make sure that as people are coming in, they're being handed the green sheets so that anyone who comes afterwards that didn't get the memo. One of the things I'm going to say this again at the end of the debate. I understand that people have some strong views on the topic of this debate, but either affirmative or negative. What we're going to do is let both Chris and Len debate here. Now, we're doing this debate is not how conferences do debates. When a conference has a debate, they do it at the end of the conference to not ruin the conference. Okay? We're doing it, striving for eternity, we don't do things the normal way. We're doing it beginning. Why? We want you guys to be able to continue discussing these things. If you have questions of either Len or Chris, that you can have them over the weekend and discuss them. But if you want to debate, if you feel that Chris or Len just did not debate your side well enough, this is not the place for you to take that debate on. If you want to debate Len, he is open to the debate anytime on the Bible Thumping Wingnut podcast. If you want to debate Chris, he is open to that debate anytime on the Rethinking Hell podcast. That's the place for the debate. You have questions over the weekend, that's good. That's why we're doing it in the beginning so that we can discuss these things. But we're not looking to have a continuing debate with folks here, okay? We don't want it to ruin the rest of the conference. If it does become an issue, we will kindly ask you to leave. But we don't want to have to do that, basically. So here's the thing. That's the instructions we have for you guys. So I'll start with the debate topic is going to be, is conditional immortality biblical? On the affirmative is going to be Chris Date. Chris Date is with a podcast called Rethinking Hell. That kind of gives away his position, just saying. But Chris is going to take the affirmative. Len Pettis is going to take the negative. He is from Bible Thumping Wingnut podcast. And so you can find more about each of them from their podcasts. One of the things is that both of these individuals see each other as brothers in Christ. This is not a thing where one's calling the other a heretic. So I'm saying that you shouldn't be calling anyone here up on this stage, except for maybe me, a heretic after. everyone agrees with that anyway. So what we're going to do is Chris is going to have a 20-minute opening, followed by Len, who's going to have a 20-minute opening. Then Chris is going to have a 10-minute cross-examination. Len is then going to have a 10-minute cross-examination. Then we're going to take a 10-minute break. During that break is the only time that I will be able to get all of the questions. So if you have questions from their opening or their cross-examination of each other, you guys got to make sure that you write those questions down during the break immediately. Before you go talking to someone, you got to get it to the back table, or you need to bring it up here to me, because I'm going to get those during that break. And those questions are going to be what we're going to be using for after the break. We're going to have basically Chris is going to give an affirmative rebuttal, Len is going to give a 10-minute affirmative rebuttal, and then we're going to have those questions for a 20-minute discussion. All right, so that's how we're going to do this. It is exactly 3:30. So if you're ready.
As ready as I'll ever be.
Why don't we do this first? Let's start with a word of prayer. All right. Lord, we're grateful that we could be here. We know that both Chris and Len do not agree on this particular topic, but it is good to see that when we are in your presence, there's going to be a lot of people who we didn't agree with on earth that we're going to see. And may this time be something to sharpen all of us. Even if we disagree with one of the other positions, may it be something that sharpens us and gets us to study out what your word teaches more. That's the goal, is that we would be more like iron sharpening iron. So we ask that you would just be with both of the debaters here, that they would have clarity of mind and explain the things that they have studied, and just help to calm their nerves and be able to present to the folks here the things that they have studied. In Christ's name we say, amen.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. I want to begin by thanking my esteemed opponent and friend, Len Pettis of the Bible Thumping Wingnut, for inviting me to participate, and Andrew Rappaport and Striving for Eternity Ministries for hosting us. I'm grateful for the work that both ministries are doing for the kingdom of God to his glory, and I appreciate that they have treated me as a brother in Christ. Most of all, I want to thank you, our audience, and those watching from afar for attending this important debate. I'm confident that, like me, you are passionate about and committed to the authority of the Word of God, the theme of this year's conference. And it is the Word of God alone which convinced me and convinces me still that the position that I'm going to be defending today. I contend that if one faithfully applies sound hermeneutical principles as one reads the Word of God, one will conclude that it teaches conditional immortality. Experts in exegesis like conservative evangelicals Walter Kaiser and John F. Johnson rightly insist that as Christians, we should base a doctrine not on a few assorted and superficially linked proof texts of questionable relevance, but on passages actually referring to the doctrine under question, its seis doctrinae, Latin for seat of doctrine. In fact, conservative Lutheran Chris Roseborough, host of Pirate Christian Radio's Fighting for the Faith, has appealed to this principle in critiquing my view of hell. And yet, this hermeneutical principle poses a problem for those who, like him, affirm what has become the now traditional view of hell as eternal torment, because very few biblical texts qualify as Sadie's doctrinae for any doctrine focused specifically on what will take place in hell. Conditional immortality, on the other hand, is about more than the nature of hell and sits comfortably atop a much larger seat of doctrine. Conditional immortality, or conditionalism for short, maintains that life is the Creator's provisional gift to all, but will ultimately be granted to the saved forever as the gift of immortality, and revoked from the lost forever as the punishment of death, body and soul. This most infamously contrasts with the traditional view in that they think the damned will be raised back to life from the dead and will go on living and suffering forever in hell. Conditionalists think instead that the resurrected lost will be punished with everlasting death, probably induced by painful means like most forms of execution, and thereby deprived of life of any sort forever. But conditionalism is also a view of who will endure in life and enjoy length of days forever, that is, who will be immortal. Most Christians think that everyone is or will be immortal, but conditionalists believe that immortality is a gift that God will grant only to those who meet the condition of being united in faith to the immortal Redeemer. Conditionalism is also, therefore, a view of the gospel, of the telos or purpose of salvation. Most Christians seem to think that the gospel is intended to rescue people from an eternity of misery by granting them an eternity of life, of bliss in fellowship with God and his people. But conditionalists maintain that the gospel is primarily about receiving everlasting life in God's glorious kingdom rather than finally perishing. Thus, conditionalism's Sadie's doctrine, its seat of doctrine, is like a three-legged stool, each leg representing a body of biblical texts conveying one of these three themes. First, life from death as the purpose of the gospel. Second, immortality as a gift that God will grant only to the saved. And third, death and destruction as what will happen in hell. The first leg of the stool is the telos or purpose of the gospel, and according to New Testament and Pauline scholar Douglas Moo, the gospel is the theme of Paul's letter to the Romans. To Paul, the gospel is about being rescued from death to life, and so he says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, the Greek word translated death is thanatos, and by Paul's time, it had a long semantic history of referring to ordinary death, the end of mortal life. This is its normal meaning in the Septuagint Greek translation of the Old Testament and in the New Testament. It is sometimes said that the concept of death can be applied to a manner of life that is disobedient to God or lived apart from fellowship with God, spiritual death, if you will. Now, this may be true, but what does not follow is that this might be the meaning of death in Romans 6:23. To assume that would be to commit what traditionalist D.A. Carson calls the fallacy of illegitimate totality transfer, which is the transfer of a word's entire range of meaning into any single use of the word. You see, the question is not whether death can be used spiritually. The death is what Paul means by it here. And to answer this question, we employ the grammatical historical method of exegesis, which attempts to uncover the meaning that the text would have had to its original human author and readers. According to conservative evangelical Grant Osborne, expert in hermeneutics, the meaning of a passage, according to this hermeneutic, is most heavily influenced by its immediate literary context. Well, immediately after Romans 6:23, Paul says that followers of Christ have been released from the law the way that a wife is released from marriage when her husband dies. Ordinary death thus lies even behind Paul's metaphor when he says believers have died to the law and have died to sin. He says in Romans 6:3 that we were baptized into Jesus' literal physical death. Paul had said a little earlier in Romans 5:12 and 17 that sin came into the world through one man and death through sin, but much more will those who receive the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Now we can tell that Paul has ordinary death in mind because in verse 14 he observes that virtually everyone died from Adam to Moses despite the lack of a law. So here in Romans 5, Paul contrasts the physical death that was introduced by sin with the free gift of life in Christ. And so the contrast in Romans 6:23, likewise between a death caused by sin and the free gift of life in Christ, is best understood as referring to a literal death, as ordinarily understood. In fact, the family of death words refers to ordinary death throughout the book of Romans. Paul uses them to say it is the due penalty, death that is, or result of sin in Romans 1:32, 5, 12, and 17, and 6, 16. He uses them to refer to the literal death of Christ and others, including immediately before Romans 6:23 in verses 8 to 10 and chapter 7, verses 2 to 3. He uses them of the state of being literally dead, again, just before and after Romans 6:23 in verses 4 and 9 and chapter 7, verse 4. So the immediate and larger context of Romans 6:23 indicate clearly that in Paul's view, the gospel of Jesus Christ aims to rescue sinners from death, as we ordinarily understand the word, by means of the free gift of everlasting life. And this really should come as no surprise, for in the most famous verse in the Bible, Jesus says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." When used of human beings in what Greek linguists call the middle voice, as it is here, the Greek apolemy, translated perish, means to die. In fact, Jesus had just said in verses 14 and 15 that he is like Moses' bronze serpent, which saved the lives of those who otherwise would have literally died by snake bite. We also see this purpose of the gospel in one of the passages most often pointed to as evidence for eternal torment. Jesus says in Matthew 25:46, "These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." Now, it is often argued that if eternal life is an everlasting experience of living, then surely eternal punishment must be an everlasting experience of being punished. But in reality, although the repeated use of the adjective aionios means that both fates are equally everlasting in duration, the judicial context means that they are mutually exclusive in nature. Only the righteous will live forever. The fate of the unrighteous must, therefore, be death forever. Now, this doesn't mean that punishing will go on forever. When aionios describes similar nouns that are related to verbs in the New Testament, it typically describes the result of those corresponding verbs as eternal, not their ongoing process. For example, in Hebrews 9:12, Jesus is said to have secured eternal redemption once for all. You see, the process of redeeming lasted for a time and was done, never to be repeated. We are not Catholics after all. But its outcome, redemption, is everlasting. Likewise, the process of punishing the lost, that is, the act of executing them, may last for a time, but its outcome, the punishment that is death, will be everlasting. So you see, the gospel is not meant to rescue sinners from an eternal life in misery, separated from God by giving them an eternal life in bliss and communion with him. No, the gospel is about saving lives altogether, rescuing sinners from certain death by granting them eternal life in the community of God's redeemed people. That is the first leg of the stool that is conditionalism's seat of doctrine. The second leg of the stool consists of texts which indicate that immortality is a gift that God will grant only to the saved. We begin in Genesis 3, which records mankind's fall into mortality, when in verse 19, God declares that as a consequence of Adam's sin, to dust you shall return. And in verses 22 and 23, he evicts Adam and Eve from the garden so that lacking access to the tree of life, they will not eat and live forever. Kenneth Matthews, who teaches Old Testament and biblical interpretation at Beeson Divinity School, explains that Adam's death penalty comes by the reversal of the man's God-given state as a living being. This reversal is the deterioration of the body that will return to the dust from which it was made. But Matthews goes on to note that God did not execute the death penalty by taking Adam's life immediately, but by banning him from the rejuvenating power of the tree of life. Adam's expulsion from the garden sealed his doom and of all who followed. Thankfully, praise God, the hope of immortality is not forever lost, but it is found only in Christ. The tree of life, which would have sustained the lives of Adam and Eve indefinitely, makes a reappearance at the other end of the Bible in Revelation 22:2, where the saved, and they alone, enjoy its fruit. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:53-55, that death will be defeated when believers are raised back to life and will never die, made fit to inherit the kingdom of God by putting on immortality. Here, immortality translates another word in that Thanatos family, the word athanasia, which literally means deathlessness. Now, it's important that tradition be allowed to play its proper role in hermeneutics. Dan McCartney and Charles Clayton rightly insist that it is folly to insist on standing on our own two feet rather than on the shoulders of giants. And if we're honest, the traditional view is called the traditional view for a reason. It has dominated the Christian tradition for centuries. So, listen to how it has answered the question of who shall receive immortality. In the second century, Tatian wrote that the lost soul rises again at the last of the end of the world with the body and will receive the painful with immortality. Some 300 years later, Augustine said, immortality shall be hereafter in the bodies of the damned. Over 1,000 years later, Article 37 of the Reformation's Belgic Confession reads, the wicked being immortal shall be tormented in that everlasting fire. William Shedd, writing another 2.5 centuries later, said, man is an immortal being. I could go on and on and on. But there were earlier and later Christian voices of dissent. Ignatius in the first century said that Jesus, the bread from heaven, is the medicine of immortality and an antidote to prevent us from dying. Irenaeus in the second century said that the one who rejects God's gift of life deprives himself of continuance and length of days forever and ever. Arnobius said in the third century that hellfire leaves nothing behind, inducing the last end annihilation. And their collective voice began to reemerge in the 19th century when conditionalism became so popular amongst Christians that its advocates thought the traditional view was on the verge of collapse. So tradition's role in hermeneutics does not demand an alternative to the plain reading of biblical texts which appear to teach that only the saved will be granted immortality. This second leg of the stool that is conditionalism's seat of doctrine, with the support of several early respected Christian thinkers, powerfully challenges the tradition that has dominated since, which maintains that the lost will be made immortal as well. Now, before moving on to the third leg, there's an important hermeneutical principle called analogia fidei, or analogy of faith. R.C. Sproul calls this the primary rule of hermeneutics, saying that no part of Scripture can be interpreted in such a way as to render it in conflict with what is clearly taught elsewhere in Scripture. And one thing that Scripture teaches very clearly is the doctrine of substitutionary atonement, which is the view that Jesus stood in our place and suffered what we deserve so that we won't have to. Now, how do the traditional view and conditional immortality fare in light of this clear biblical teaching? Well, as we've seen, and as we conditionalists can affirm, God grants believers immortality so as to save their lives from certain death, as ordinarily understood. And of course, that's what Christ suffered in our place as our substitute. Scripture is consistent and emphatic about this, the substitutionary bodily death of Jesus. As just two examples among many, Paul says in Colossians 1:21-22, that Christ has now reconciled you in his body of flesh by his death. And Peter says in 1 Peter 3:18 that Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh. Meanwhile, again, the traditional view of hell maintains that the resurrected lost will be made immortal and will never ever die. So from the perspective of substitutionary atonement, conditionalism fares far better than the traditional view when it comes to the analogy of faith. Jesus died in place of sinners, suffering what they deserve, so those who must face that punishment themselves must likewise die, not be made immortal and live forever. You see, we conditionalists can say that Jesus truly died in the place of his people so that they will instead live, and that the lost who deny him will not. Now, the third leg of the stool that is traditionalism's seat of doctrine consists of texts indicating that what will happen in hell is that the lost will die, perish, and be destroyed. The fiery destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah and the execution of their inhabitants is cited in Jude 7 and 2 Peter 2:6 as an example of final punishment. The meaning of Peter's words in particular seem unmistakable. By turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, Peter writes, God condemned them to extinction, making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly. And then in 2 Peter 3, 5-7, Peter compares those who literally perished in Noah's flood to the future destruction of the lost. Jesus says in Mark 9, 43-48, that it is better to enter the kingdom alive and maimed than to be cast instead into Gehenna, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. Now, besides implying that the fate is death by saying that it is better to enter life maimed, Jesus is quoting Isaiah 66, 24, where the hosts of those worms in that fire are the corpses of God's slain enemies, not tormented living people. You see, a fire that can't be extinguished completely consumes, precisely how it's used in the Old Testament, like in texts like in Ezekiel 20, 47 to 48, and Amos 5, 5 to 6, and New Testament texts, like Matthew 3, 12, in which unquenchable fire is said to burn up chaff, the Greek katakaio, meaning to burn something up, to reduce to ashes. As this unquenchable fire is parallel in Mark 9, 48 and Isaiah 66, 24, the undying worm is a maggot, which can't be prevented by death from fully consuming its meal. You see, in a very similar picture in Jeremiah 7:32-33, it is fear which won't prevent scavengers from completely devouring corpses. And there, God says Gehenna will become known as the Valley of Slaughter, and the dead bodies of this people will be food for the birds of the air and for the beasts of the earth, and none will frighten them away. Even Revelation 14:9-11 and 20:10, despite being so frequently cited as support for the doctrine of eternal torment, prove upon closer examination to teach that in hell the wicked will die, perish, and be destroyed. From the principle of analogy of faith follows a well-accepted hermeneutical principle which demands that obscure passages of Scripture should be interpreted in light of clear passages. With its bizarre apocalyptic imagery, Revelation is notoriously one of the most obscure books of the Bible and should be interpreted in light of the many clearer texts that I've cited throughout my presentation thus far. Gordon Fee and Douglas Stewart observe that the stuff of apocalyptic is presented in the form of visions and dreams, and its language is cryptic and symbolic. And due to Revelation's extreme reliance upon Old Testament images and themes, Osborne rightly urges readers, in moving from the symbol to the reality and in visions, the reader should seek first the biblical background behind such symbols and then use this to interpret later allusions. So let's apply all of this to these texts in Revelation. Revelation 14:9-11 depicts, number one, beast worshippers drinking the strongest measure of God's wrath, number two, in fire and sulfur, number three, smoke rising forever from their restless torment. Okay, in Obadiah 16 and Jeremiah 25, 27, drinking the fullest measure of God's wrath results in death. The fire and sulfur that rains down upon Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis 19 kills their inhabitants. The smoke that rises from those cities the next morning and the smoke that rises forever and ever from Edom in Isaiah 34, 10 rises from their remains. Even elsewhere in Revelation itself, the imagery is used in this way. The harlot, Mystery Babylon, drinks the wine of God's wrath in 1619 and 18:6. She is tormented in fire in 18:7, 10, and 15, and smoke rises for her from her forever in 19:3. But the interpreting angel tells John in 18:21 that this imagery symbolizes the total destruction of the city that that harlot represents. Now, as for Revelation 20:10-15, in which the resurrected lost are seen thrown into a lake of fire in which the devil, beast, and false prophet are tormented forever, death and Hades are also thrown into it in verse 14 after being the dead are removed out of them, symbolizing what Paul said plainly in 1 Corinthians 15:26, the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Indeed, John says in Revelation 21:4, Hathanatos uk esti eti, death shall be no more. If imagery here is to be treated consistently, the devil, the beast, and the false prophet, and the risen lost must all be destroyed as well. When all of God's enemies have been destroyed and those who remain will never die, death will have been destroyed. And this is why in Revelation 20:14 and 21:8, John and God interpret the lake of fire as symbolizing the second death, meaning that death is the clearer reality symbolized by the perplexing image. The resurrected lost will literally die a second time and forever. So these texts join many others as the third leg of the stool that is conditionalism's seat of doctrine, teaching that in hell, the resurrected lost will die, perish, and be destroyed, rather than live immortal forever. So let's recap. I began by explaining the need to avoid mere proof texting and by applying the interpretive principle of Sadie's Doctrinae, basing my theological conclusions as a conditionalist on a broad seat of doctrine. In substantiating the stool's first leg, I employed the grammatical historical method of exegesis by examining the immediate and larger literary context of Romans 6:23 and John 3:16, which teach that the gospel is intended to rescue sinners from death by giving them life. I substantiated the stool's second leg, citing texts which indicate that immortality is a gift God will grant only to the saved, and noting the existence of early Christian thinkers who agreed, thus letting tradition play its proper hermeneutical role. I appealed to the hermeneutical principle of analogy of faith, interpreting scripture using scripture by noting that to rescue sinners from death, Jesus died in their place. And in substantiating the third leg of the stool, I cited texts indicating that in hell the lost will die, perish, and be destroyed, including the obscure apocalyptic symbolism of Revelation. As I explained, hermeneutics demands that we interpret this imagery in light of the many clearer texts my case is based upon, and that it be interpreted first in light of its use in the Old Testament where it communicated death and destruction. By all biblical indications, the resurrected lost will not live immortal in hell forever, but will instead die there and forever. Thank you.
Sorry. That's exact. Just a quick reminder, while I've already said this before you start, if you have questions, please go in the back. That you want to ask of the debaters later, please go to the back, grab the green sheets, and fill those out. Tim, if you can grab, if people are online have questions, if they can maybe communicate, I don't know if they can do that through Mixler, but if you have questions, please say who the question's for and then what the question is. You have 20 minutes.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you. Everyone for coming, and thank you, Chris, for accepting my debate challenge. I'm sitting here wondering what I have gotten myself into. But with all of that said, the question up for debate today is whether conditional immortality is biblical. Chris defines conditional immortality this way, as he stated, that life is the Creator's provisional gift to all, but will ultimately be granted to the saved forever as the gift of immortality, and revoked from the lost forever as the punishment of annihilation. In other words, hell is an eternal punishment, but the sinner who goes there is not eternal in body, soul, or spirit. Debating against this position forces me to understand it. So in a Facebook message on December 6th, I restated Chris's position back to him for clarity to ensure that I understand him properly, and I restated it to him this way, quote, "Once a person dies, they go into a state of soul sleep until final judgment at the end of the age when Christ resurrects the dead for final judgment. Once they are raised, immortality is granted by God to the elect, and the reprobate are sentenced to death, the second death, where they are literally killed to live no more. In this way, the punishment is eternal in that they are eternally dead and miss out on the immortality or eternal life granted by God." This was Chris's response, and I quote, "Actually, I think your wording of my view of eternal punishment is fine. I would just prefer to emphasize the punitive character of the death. And he quotes here, "In this way, their punishment is eternal, that their punishment is death, and that they are eternally dead." So Chris wants you to rethink hell today in the namesake of his podcast. And I'm here to tell you that you should no more rethink hell than you should rethink the biblical view of marriage, gender roles in the church, the deity of Christ, the Trinity, or penal substitutionary atonement. I'm here because this is an issue that cuts to the heart of the very gospel itself. My job here today is to demonstrate that this doctrine of conditional immortality should be rejected as unbiblical because I believe that any doctrine outside of the biblical view of hell, eternal conscious torment, impacts the gospel in such a way that it logically and biblically renders the gospel ineffectual to those who hold the position and creates a false gospel for those who reject the biblical gospel as taught by Christ and the apostles. Tonight, I want our focus, as Chris does, to be on the scriptures. I believe that the case for hell is bound within the pages of the Bible. So any deviation I make from that will only be cursory. And when I do, I'll be appealing to scholars that I think Chris and I both agree are authorities. Also, I'm no Greek or Hebrew scholar. So I may appeal to the original languages at certain points. But again, that will be on the authority of trusted resources. I sincerely hope we don't get bogged down in these areas, as I'm sure Chris and I both agree that the scriptures that we have in English are clear enough to teach us what God would have us know. Now, the difficulty I have in this debate is that there, I believe, is a mountain of biblical evidence that stands against Chris's position, and I have to decide which ones are the strongest in the limited time that I have. So with that said, my first argument for the biblical view of hell is that eternal conscious torment for the impenitent sinner is found in John 3:36, which states, "He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him." Here we see that God's wrath abides on the sinner. The Greek word found here is meno, and it's used in the scripture 118 times. The definition and its semantic range are as follows: to remain or abide, in reference to time, to continue to be, not to perish, to last and endure; of persons, to live and survive. In reference to a state or condition, it means to remain as one and not become another or different. Following are some samples of the other places we see meno used, and I think you'll see the relevance at this point. John 1:32 says this: "John testified, saying, I have seen the Spirit descending as a dove out of heaven, and he remained on him." He menoed, stayed on him. John 5:38, "You do not have his word abiding in you," meno, "for you do not believe him whom he sent." 1 Peter 1:25 says, "But the word of the Lord remains forever," meno, "and this word is the good news that was preached to you." John 15:10 says, "If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and I abide in his love." John 6:27 says, "Do not work for food which perishes, but for the food which endures," meno, "to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, for on him the Father God has set his seal." So we can see a clear pattern developing in the scriptures here. The Spirit of God abides, God's word abides, the love of Christ and the love of the Father abide, and the gospel abides. What then do we say of God's wrath? It abides, does it not? And here we have one of the many logical and hermeneutical problems for Chris's position. Let me first show you what Chris might try to do with this when they encounter this text and why I believe they get it wrong. First, he would say the verse itself says, "He who believes in the Son has eternal life," and he'll focus on that word life, and then imposes exegesis on the text and ignore what it is clearly saying. In fact, I'm sure Chris is probably chomping at the bit to refute this verse right now, and he'll say, "See, it's the Son who gives eternal life. It's a gift from God," and we'll all say amen. But Chris's exegesis demands that you ignore the latter half of the verse, which clearly teaches the consequence of rejecting the gospel. God's wrath abides on you, and it isn't going anywhere, ever. Further, Chris will impose upon you an exegesis of the word life that demands you take a strict wooden literalist view that life must mean the quantity or the length of life and not necessarily the quality. Now, part of hermeneutics is understanding, as Chris said, how the audience to these books were written, how they would have understood them, and I don't think it's proper for us to impose our Western 21st century literalism on an ancient 2,000-year-old document whose writers and readers used much more hyperbole in their language than many of us today would be comfortable with. Now, Chris does much the same things as we've already heard with words such as death and destroy, and we'll also see it probably later with words like Sheol and Gehenna. Now, there's also a logical problem with the conditional immortality that relates to John 3:36. Conditionalists might try to convince us that God's abiding wrath does not depend on the continued existence of the sinner for it to be abiding, that God's anger can burn eternally against a sinner who no longer exists. I want you to consider the implications of this. We acknowledge that God's wrath is measured, perfect, and holy. To believe that God's wrath would abide on something that no longer exists, or that he would remain eternally embittered to the memory of a dead sinner who no longer exists in any sense, makes God more like the Roman Catholic Church who dug up the remains of John Wycliffe 44 years after they executed him, just to have his bones crushed and disposed of in the river. God is not bitter, unreasonable, or unhinged in his wrath. Furthermore, Matthew 18:8, Matthew 25:41 both have a specific construction in the Greek called an article noun, article adjective construction, which affirms that the fire in and of itself is eternal, though started and sustained by God, and it is categorically different than other fires that burn. These specific passages are semantically linked with Gehenna, unquenchable fire, and eternal punishment in both Matthew and Mark's gospel. Now, Chris might say that eternal torment makes God no different, and maybe worse, because he keeps sinners alive for the very purpose of tormenting them eternally. Now, if that's what Chris believes, and I think it is, we can see the error in his presuppositions. First, that the sinner is not deserving of eternal conscious torment for their sin against a holy God, and two, that their sinning has ceased, and what God is doing is unreasonable in continuing to punish them. If they are not deserving of such, then why are the beast and false prophet, both human and in birth and nature, shown to have continued physical punishment in existence in Revelation 19 and 20, just like the rich man in Luke 16 and the inhabitants of Sodom and Gomorrah in Jude 7? These are questions that I hope to hear Chris answer today. My second argument revolves around the doctrine of propitiation, specifically where 1 John 2:2 is concerned, which reads, "He is the propitiation for our sin, not only ours, but for the sin of the whole world." You can also see this in 1 John 4:10. In the Koine Greek, the word for propitiation comes from the word halasmos, which means to appease, as in God's wrath, or atone for. The word propitiation carries the basic idea of appeasement or satisfaction specifically toward God. Charles C. Ryrie writes in Basic Theology, a popular systematic guide to understanding biblical truth, and I quote, "Propitiation means the turning away of wrath by an offering. In relation to soteriology, that is the doctrine of salvation, propitiation means placating or satisfying the wrath of God by the atoning sacrifice of Christ." Matthew Henry put it this way, "Jesus Christ is the great propitiation or propitiatory sacrifice typified in the hilasterion or mercy seat under the law. He is our throne of grace, in and whom atonement is made for sin." This from Barnes Notes on the Bible, quote, "The proper meaning of the word is that of reconciling, appeasing, turning away anger, rendering propitious or favorable. The idea is that there is anger or wrath and that something has been done to offend and that it is needful to turn away that wrath or to appease," unquote. On the doctrine of propitiation, conditional immortality forces you to put on your hermeneutical blinders and causes a scripture to become self-contradictory. Notice the definite article in 1 John, "he," the "he" being Christ, and this verse is using exclusive language, as I'm sure Chris would agree, that Christ alone can satisfy God's righteous and just wrath toward a sinner. That is, unless you're a conditionalist. If you're a conditionalist, you unknowingly make the unregenerate sinner his or her own propitiation for God's wrath. Now let's put on our presuppositional glasses and examine this real closely here. If a sinner is ultimately destroyed in a way that causes the cessation of existence, God's wrath is satisfied in that destruction, thus making the sinner his own propitiation, not Christ. Now, doesn't that contradict what we just talked about in 1 John 2:2? Absolutely. Christ alone is the propitiation for sin, and neither man, another imagined God, or another sacrifice which can propitiate the abiding wrath of the Almighty Triune God. And on that basis alone, you should reject the doctrine of conditional immortality and dismiss it as unbiblical. My final argument against conditional immortality can be summed up in two words, the cross. On the cross, Christ experienced everything that a sinner will experience in hell: mental anguish, physical torment, and separation from God. And even if Christ's separation or any of these things weren't eternal, as Chris may retort, the fact that the eternal God hung on the cross and that he did so for any amount of time is far more than he deserved and thus sufficient for the atonement. Christ's eternality and godness make the time frame almost irrelevant. Just look at Luke 16 and the story of the rich man and Lazarus. I'm not going to take time to read the whole account, but here's what is notable. We see the physical torment in verse 23, as it says he's being tormented in the flames. In verse 24, the rich man states that he is in anguish. In verse 26, Abraham tells the rich man that there's a great chasm fixed between them, which can never be bridged. On the cross, Christ suffered everything that the rich man experienced, right down to his very thirst. There are those who would argue that Luke 16 is a parable, and I believe Chris is one of those people. To my knowledge, the only people that historically argued Luke 16 as a parable were heretics like the Seventh-day Adventists and Jehovah's Witnesses, who presuppositionally denied eternal conscious torment, but instead argued for a doctrine of soul sleep, a doctrine which I believe Chris also affirms. And only some modern scholars have taken up the argument that this is parabolic and thus need not be interpreted as conscious torment. I simply argue that if it is a parable and the conscious torment that the rich man was experiencing isn't actual, then we have no reason to think in the context of this narrative that the eternal bliss that Lazarus was enjoying is actual either. Thus, the passage is rendered functionally and spiritually useless for determining anything about the nature of the afterlife, which is quite contrary to the very purpose of this scripture. The problem those who hold to conditional immortality have is that Christ never ceased to exist. If Christ suffered hell on the cross to propitiate God's abiding wrath on the sinner, yet Christ never ceased to exist, that means that the atoning work of Christ on the cross is incomplete. Yet as a Calvinist, Chris would affirm that the atonement is definite. In other words, Christ's propitiation was complete, perfect, and fully satisfied the wrath of God for the elect. Yet the conditionalist view of the atonement is both logically and biblically incomplete. If the atonement is incomplete, then how can there be salvation for the conditionalist? That's another question I hope to hear Chris answer. And I see you typing, so I'm sure you will. Furthermore, I want you to consider the implication of this doctrine for the unbeliever. What do you call it when a sinner is spared from the wrath of God? Is that not good news? That is it not good news for a sinner to be spared from the wrath of God for any period of time? This system creates a false gospel, one in which an unbeliever is spared God's wrath for all eternity. Now, Mark Twain once famously said, "I do not fear death. I had been dead for billions and billions of years before I was born, and had not suffered the slightest inconvenience from it." In a discussion about death with Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, a famous atheist, said, "We're not filled with fear and trembling about all those years that passed before we were alive, so it shouldn't bother us at all that there will be all these years that come after we're not alive." Conditional immortality is not just good news for the God-hating unbeliever, it makes them right. In closing, I want you to keep in mind the theme of our conference this weekend, the Word of God. We're going to sit under the teaching of four fine teachers who are going to help us rightly divide the word of truth, to apply sound hermeneutics. And that's really the disconnect here between Chris and I, because we agree on almost everything else. But the disconnect we have here is hermeneutics. Now, Chris, I love Chris, but Chris reminds me of one of my favorite Bible characters who I also love. His name is Nicodemus. And I want you to think about Nicodemus when you hear Chris apply his hermeneutics to the verses which he uses to demonstrate why he believes wholeheartedly that his position is the biblical one. We first meet Nicodemus in John chapter 3, and there we read that Jesus is sharing an amazing spiritual truth with Nicodemus about the second birth. Nicodemus here makes the same error as Chris in interpreting the words of Christ when he asks Jesus this question in verse 4. How can a man be born when he's old? Can he not enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Just like Nicodemus, Chris takes a wooden literal approach to his proof text when he looks at words like destruction and imposes his presupposition that it must mean cessation of existence. But what does Chris do with texts like 2 Thessalonians 1:9, the eternal destruction away from the Lord's presence? What does he do with that? Obviously, destruction can't be taken literally here. It seems obvious to me that this passage indicates the eternal punishment of the wicked. And when he looks at words like death and insists that that also must mean the cessation of existence, not to mention again words like Sheol and Gehenna, which to agree with Chris's interpretation requires sound hermeneutics to be turned on its head. Hermeneutics done right would have the unclear verses of Scripture interpreted through the lenses of the clear verses. But to justify the doctrine of conditional immortality, you must pull the shade over the light and interpret the unclear without regard to the clear, as we see he tries to do when he interprets Daniel 12, 1 and 2, Matthew 25, 46, Revelation 14, 10, Revelation 20, 10, and others. And I don't mean to poison the well here, be derogatory when I compare Chris to Nicodemus, but I think as you listen to him with Nicodemus in mind, you're going to hear what I mean. Is conditional immortality biblical? Absolutely not. Does that mean that Chris or any other conditionalist should be dismissed and regarded as heretics? Not necessarily, and especially not in the case of my opponent tonight. I'm on the clock. Give me another
minute. You got another minute.
I'm out of gas.
All right. Carl, can you hit the record on that? That's not recording. So we're now going to go into a 10-minute where Chris is going to cross-examine Len. So this is going to be where, Len, you will have a one... Chris, you'll ask your question. You'll have a two-minute response.
I think that's in the open.
Oh, that's good. We're going to do this in the rebuttal part. Okay. Okay. So it's just going to be your full 10-minute, that's right.
Yeah, like to the time.
You can call the time.
Yeah.
Be nice, Chris.
You were nice.
He mentioned him in a lot.
That's true. That's what made it so bad. We ready? All righty. So Len, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:42 that body sown perishable, phthara, will be raised imperishable, aphthousia. He says in verse 53 that formerly mortal, netas, our bodies being raised will put on immortality, athanasia. Would you agree that Paul is talking only about the resurrection bodies of believers here?
Yes.
John MacArthur says of the distinction between perishable and imperishable in this passage that, quote, it pertains to durability. One of the most obvious characteristics of all natural life, including human life, is that it is perishable, subject to deterioration and eventual death, but the resurrection body of the believer will be raised an imperishable body. Our new bodies will know no sickness, decay, deterioration, or death, unquote. Do you think that MacArthur here accurately captures Paul's idea of imperishability in 1 Corinthians 15?
I will not sit here and disagree with John MacArthur.
All right. I would not. Not on this point, though. In Genesis 3:22, God says, lest man reach out his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. And then he sends man out of the garden and guards the way to the tree of life from them. In their commentary on Genesis 3:21-24, D.A. Carson, R.T. France, and Gordon Wenham write that expulsion from the garden proved the hollowness of the serpent's promise that they would not die. Now the full cost of sin is apparent, ultimately physical death. Sorry about that. Would you agree that Adam and Eve's lack of access to the tree of life secured their eventual demise?
Their physical death?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I would say it secured their physical death, yes.
Revelation 22:2 says of the great city and the final imagery of John's apocalyptic vision that on either side of a river flowing through the city is the tree of life. Would you agree that only the redeemed will have access to this city and the tree of life?
Yes.
G.K. Beale, pointing out that if Adam had been able to eat from it, he would have been able to live forever, comments on this passage in Revelation, saying that it symbolizes that Christ suffered death on believers' behalf in the present age so that he would not have to suffer it in the age to come. Would you agree that access to the tree of life in Revelation, limited to the redeemed, symbolizes that they will live forever?
Yes.
In Luke 20:35-36, Jesus says, those who were considered worthy to attain to that age and to the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage, for they cannot die anymore. Bruce Metzger observes that several Western manuscripts say they will not die anymore. Darrell Bach, commenting on this passage, explains the connection. After the resurrection, Bach writes, relationships change. Putting on immortality, and here Bach is mentioning that Corinthians passage again, putting on immortality means there is no need to create new mortals. There is no more death, and there's no more need to worry about continuing one's family line. So would you agree with Bach that Jesus is here saying the resurrected saints will never again die?
Yes.
So can you point us then, in light of all of that, to any passage anywhere in Scripture that similarly says of the resurrected lost that they too will never die?
Well, I would say, for one example, in your opening statement, you said that death shall be no more.
Mm-hmm.
So if death shall be no more, and yet death is the final punishment, then I would say that that contradicts your position, not mine.
Okay, I'll look forward to you asking me that in your turn of cross-examination. In the meantime, I'll prepare it for rebuttal. So let me shift gears then. Do you affirm the doctrine of substitutionary atonement?
Of course.
In an article at karm.org, Matt Slick says this means that Christ took our place and suffered our punishment. Would you agree?
Yes.
Matt also says in this article that Christ's death was a legal payment, that it was substitutionary in that Jesus paid the legal requirement of the punishment of sin, death. Would you agree?
Yes.
1 Peter 3:18 says Jesus was put to death in the flesh. The famous pierced for our transgressions text in Isaiah 53 says that in verse 12, that he poured out himself to death. In 1 Corinthians 15:3-4, Paul says the gospel is in part that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised. Would you agree then that Christ's atoning substitutionary death was at least a physical death?
Not in full. It was a physical death, but not just a physical death.
But it was a physical death.
It was a physical death, but not just a physical death.
But it was a physical death.
Not just a physical death. Any more than the death of Adam was just physical.
Okay. Now, before our debate, we agreed that in near view, the lost will come back to physical life and physically live forever in torment. And it sounds like you're still affirming that, correct?
Correct.
Is there any biblical evidence that what Christ suffered as our substitute was, in fact, a living torment, not culminating in death?
What do you mean?
Well, you've said that the punishment awaiting the lost is everlasting. I don't want to use biblical terminology because you would dispute that's what it means. You said the punishment of the lost will entail their living forever in torment, correct?
Correct.
So can you point me to any evidence in Scripture that what Jesus bore on our behalf is living torment that does not culminate in death?
That what he suffered on the cross was
a punishment that did not culminate in death, a torment that did not culminate in death.
Well, yes, his torment did culminate in death.
So you cannot point me to... I'm sorry, go ahead.
But it's not just the physical death that Christ suffered.
I know, but we agree he suffered at least a physical death.
Yes.
And the question I'm asking is, can you point me to any evidence that what Jesus bore was a punishment that does not culminate in death, a punishment that does not include death? Because your view, if I understand you correctly, is that the punishment awaiting the finally impenitent is a suffering that never culminates in death.
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't know. I think. Are you asking me did Jesus's suffering culminate in, like, it ended in death?
What I was asking for was any evidence that what Jesus suffered on our behalf was a suffering that does not culminate in death, which is what you're saying awaits the finally lost.
Yes. But it's not just, again, not just physical death.
But it was at least physical death.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's my question then. You say you affirm substitutionary atonement, which, and by the way, I didn't hear any mention of Jesus' death when you talked about substitutionary atonement in your opening, so I'll be looking forward to talking more about that. But how can you affirm substitutionary atonement and say that what Jesus suffered was the legal requirement of the punishment of sin, which was death, that's coming straight from Matt Slick's article, if you think that the risen lost, facing the ultimate penalty for sin, will in fact live forever? How is that substitutionary?
How is it substitutionary that Christ...
If the punishment that Jesus bore in our place,
yes,
was death, at least,
right,
and the punishment of the risen lost will never be death,
right,
how can that be substitutionary?
How can it be substitutionary?
Yeah. If his punishment, which according to Matt Slick's article, and I agree with this, the ultimate legal requirement for sin is death, okay? If that's what he suffered in our place, in our stead, so we don't have to, how can you say that's substitutionary when in fact the finally lost will never, ever, 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 ever die for ages upon ages upon eons of eons?
Well, because the assumption that you're making is that life is quantity only and not quality.
But
and
he did physically die.
He did physically die.
And the risen lost will not.
The risen lost will not. Their life isn't, again, we're not talking about just the extent of the time, right? We're talking about their quality as well.
But it wasn't just quality, it was also the fact of life in Jesus' case, correct? He literally died.
He literally died, and the risen lost spiritually died also.
And the risen lost will never literally die in your view.
Well, they're going to eternally die.
Will they ever lose their life like Jesus did in our behalf?
Will they ever lose their life? Well, they lose their they lose life in the sense that they...
I'm asking, do they lose life in the way that Jesus lost life? He died. He was buried. Will the risen lost ever die in that sense?
Well, what we're talking about here is his temporal death. So they will die in that way.
So he bore our temporal death as well, and yet we still will die? Because we're gonna die a temporal right. death then too, but he suffered that in our place, and yet despite him substituting for that, we're gonna die too.
Yes.
Okay, so here's, so one last question then. You said, if I understood you correctly, and I may not, you said that what Jesus bore in our place, the reason that it could qualify as the eternal suffering awaiting the lost is because Jesus is the God-man, and mm-hmm. as such, his suffering qualifies, right,
yes.
in the eternal torment.
Yes.
I have no problem with that as far as it goes, but here's the concern I have with that, and I'm interested in your thoughts in the last minute we have left during my time. Jesus, if he exhausted the eternity of torment awaiting the lost in his torment,
right?
Why did he die? Because he exhausted that full penalty in his suffering while he was still alive. When he exhausted that eternal torment, why did he die at that point? The payment was made, right?
Well, yes, the payment was made, and that the suffering, you quoted Isaiah 53, which I affirm, he was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. The chastisement that brought us peace was laid upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. I believe that part of the death that Jesus experienced was a spiritual death similar to that of Adam.
I understand.
Being the second Adam.
But the question I'm asking, just to be clear, because I only have a little bit of time left, is that you say, if I understood you correctly, that he, in his finite duration of suffering, he exhausted the infinite duration of suffering awaiting a loss,
yes.
right? So then once he paid that penalty, once the penalty was paid, why did he die?
I don't understand.
If the full penalty was paid, what penalty was there left to pay with his death?
Well, the penalty was the culmination of the payment, or the death was the culmination of the payment. You can't separate the wrath from the death.
I agree. Thanks. It's your turn.
Okay. All right. I love my cross-examination document. All right. I'm not going to go that fast.
Sorry.
Do you affirm that there is a time of punishment in hell before the sinner who is cast in there dies finally?
I believe that the final punishment of the lost is a process of being destroyed that is painful, just like being electrocuted on the electric chair is painful.
How long is that time?
Scripture doesn't tell us. The closest thing I have is the example given in Jude 7, where in 2 Peter, where they say that the example awaiting the example of final punishment is the swift and fiery destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Okay, we're going to talk about Jude 7. what is the time dependent upon? The time that they're punished, well, what is it dependent on? Is it like their weight, like a fat person takes longer to burn up than a skinny person, or what is it based upon?
You're asking me to speculate on details the Bible doesn't give. The only answer I could possibly give is the justice of God.
Okay. What is it that sustains them during their time before they are consumed to a state of non-existence?
Life, just the same way that it takes a person a few minutes to die in the electric chair or be burned at the stake or any number of other deaths. Life sustains them until they die.
And who is the author of life?
God.
Okay, so it's God who sustains them?
Well, in as much as God has granted them life until the point that life is extinguished, sure.
Okay. Is punishment a noun or a verb?
Punishment is a noun.
And we're just so I'm clear, speaking specifically of Matthew 25.
Colossus is a noun.
Okay. We'll talk about that too.
For the Colosso, I think, is the verbal form. Anyway, sorry.
For the atonement to be efficacious, would Jesus have to endure everything which a sinner who would have been otherwise condemned also endure?
I apologize. I missed something.
For the atonement to be efficacious, would Jesus need? Would it be necessary for him to endure everything which a sinner who would have been otherwise condemned also endure?
I think that in order for Jesus' atonement to be substitutionary, then that which Scripture identifies as that punishment that he bore is the punishment that should be awaiting the lost, since his punishment, since his atonement wasn't made for them. In other words, if, as I contend, the Bible says that the punishment he bore as our substitute was death, then to flip that on its head and say actually it wasn't death or that the lost won't die is to actually in fact deny substitutionary atonement. If you substitute, if I said that I stood in your place and not somebody else's, and that what I did for you was teach a class in Greek or something, I'd love to do that one day, I dream of being a professor. But in fact, you weren't ever tasked with teaching a class in Greek, and what you actually had to do was go play a game of baseball, I didn't substitute for you. So likewise, if the scriptures say that Jesus served as our substitute by dying, and as you say, the lost will never, ever, ever, ever die for millions and billions of trillions of years.
No, they're experiencing eternal death.
But they're never dying. Their body never, they never lose their life, as Jesus did. Remember, the scriptures teach that Jesus' bodily death is what he atoned for us doing. Mm-hmm. And you're saying that the risen lost will never lose their bodily life.
Okay. We just have, we just look at, I think we just are looking at what the death is differently.
Well,
the death is the separation from God in the biblical view. It's not just a physical death.
Well,
it's an ongoing physical death, in that they will never have a quality of life. They will never be in communion with God, right? But it's also a spiritual death in which Adam experienced, in which they continue.
I would be grateful for the opportunity to address Adam, but you haven't asked me that question yet. So what I will just say for now is that I totally agree that part of what the consequences of sin is to be separated relationally from God. But to say that it does not include physical death is to deny the consistent and repeated testimony of Scripture from cover to cover, including Genesis 2 and 3.
Okay. Do you affirm that Matthew 25 and do you affirm that in Matthew 25:46 the words eternal punishment mean that the results of the punishment last forever?
No.
Forever, rather than the punishment itself being eternal?
No. I've never ever said that what that means is that the result of the punishment is forever.
Okay.
Would you like me to clarify?
Please.
Okay.
Because I thought that's what you believe.
That's how my view is often mischaracterized.
Okay.
My view is that punishment being a noun, in this case, refers to the results of the verb punish. So we have in Hebrews eternal salvation, eternal redemption, and those are both nouns as well. And both of those are called eternal, aionios, same Greek adjective.
Yeah.
But what those nouns refer to is not the process of their corresponding verbs, save and redeem. We're not Catholics, guys. We're not. Well, maybe some of you are. We're not. So Jesus suffered. Jesus secured eternal redemption with a finite duration of redeeming. So likewise, eternal punishment in the context of Matthew 25:46 refers to a punishment that corresponds to the outcome of the verb punish.
Okay. If death is the ultimate punishment for sin, why was the punishment of Christ necessary?
Because if he hadn't borne the punishment of death on our behalf, then everybody would never live. They would die and they would never live again. And God for his own glory, to elevate his own glory and to secure for himself a people, he came to earth and he died on our behalf so that we would instead live.
Okay. So then you acknowledge that wrath is part of the atonement, is Jesus enduring just the wrath?
Absolutely. Right? Jesus bore the Father's wrath, which killed him.
Okay, but the death is the punishment.
Well, I think that it was a painful death. I'm willing to acknowledge that pain is included in the process of being killed, but the Scriptures repeatedly, even in the places where it mentions his suffering, repeatedly emphasizes his death. Not the process of dying, otherwise he wouldn't have had to finish dying. He could have just went on living.
Then why didn't Jesus on the cross, instead of saying, it is finished, why didn't he say, it's about to begin?
Right, that's a great question. And in reality, most Orthodox, and I don't mean the Greek or Eastern Orthodox, I mean Orthodox in the sense of being a genuine Christian, don't take tetelestai to mean that the punishment has ended at that point and then he dies. That would be, I would argue that that's actually heresy. Here's how John Calvin puts it. We're both Calvinists, I think, right?
Yeah.
So here's John Calvin on tetelestai. The word Christ uses deserves our close attention, for it shows that our salvation was completely accomplished by his death. We have already said that his resurrection is not separate from his death, but Christ only intends to keep our faith fixed on himself alone and not to allow it to deviate in any other direction. All the sacrifices of the law must have stopped, for the salvation of mankind has been completed by the one sacrifice of the death of Christ. So why did he say tetelestai? It would never happen again. It would never, ever have to happen again, contrary to Catholics who in every single week think what they're doing is re-sacrificing the Messiah.
Okay. Do you believe that innate immortality was popularized by Plato, as Edward Fudge argued?
Can you be a little bit more precise in your wording?
Well, he believes, I believe as he wrote in his book, The Fire That Consumes, which thank you.
You're welcome.
That he argues that it was Plato who popularized the idea of man's innate immortality, and that was picked up, as Fudge argues, by early church fathers and historians.
Here's the way I would answer that, and tell me if I don't do it sufficiently. Greek Platonist, Greek Platonism was not the only culture in which humans were thought to have any immortality. There were others as well. What you won't find is that in the scriptures. The scriptures consistently teach that apart from the gift of God, immortality will not be enjoyed by anybody.
Okay. As a physicalist, how can you reconcile Luke 16 and other passages which seem to clearly teach about the intermediate state before final judgment?
I'm willing, for the sake of argument, to put aside my physicalism and argue for this view from dualism, because as far as I'm concerned, the two are not
related. So you're going to argue from a position you don't hold?
My entire case was completely neutral when it comes to the state of the intermediate state, whether people are conscious there.
So you don't affirm the soul sleep?
I believe in something that is often characterized as soul sleep, but what I'm saying is that my case is wholly independent from that. And so if you'd like to try and argue, here's what I could do.
I don't think these are inseparable topics. I'm not trying to
make
a rabbit trail. I think these topics relate, and I want to argue the position that you hold. So I would like to, I just want to hear exposition on the last 50 seconds we have here on how you reconcile.
I'm willing to reconcile that, but I just want to state for the record that there is, unless and until Len is able to demonstrate that these two views are inseparable, that the only way, despite the myriad dualists who hold to my view, including Irenaeus, until you can demonstrate that they're logically linked, this is an exercise in futility. There's no point to this at all. That having been said, you asked me, the evidence appears to be from the historical record that Jesus is co-opting a folktale of sorts. It was common at the time. It's called the story of Bar. I forget the guy. Bar means son in Hebrew, and it's Bar something. But anyway, there was a story in that day that people were familiar with, and what Jesus does is he turns it on its head to communicate a different point than it was thought to communicate in the common, you know, popular literature. So he's communicating a point, but it isn't necessarily intended to say anything about the nature of the intermediate state.
Okay. Thanks. All right, so we're going to take a 10-minute break. If you have questions, quickly write them down. Put who the question is for. Put the question, either bring it up to me or bring it to the back table as soon as you can. We're going to take a 10-minute break. Also keep in mind, guys, that these are still recording, so you got to be careful what you may say.
All right.
You can't say nice things about Planet. It'll be heard.
I have nothing but nice things to say about Planet.
Heretic.
Yeah. I have a 10-minute rebuttal.
You will.
Now, I apologize. You said you wanted to hear me answer a question. I was typing, like you pointed out. What I was typing was, yeah. What is the question?
Well, there were some beer ones, too. Okay. Well, go for it.
Right. Let me get to work. So do you remember the questions?
I was putting the money on it.
Is it in your opening statement?
You don't want to hear all my questions.
I'd be grateful to hear all my questions.
No, I'll arm wrestle them. I won't draft.
So I think we kind of ran, right? I have it somewhere after your discussion. Did you have a room there about the comments you said?
Yeah.
Chris, you want me to leave you alone? You want to talk?
I want to find this question we asked.
Sure.
So hang on, switch this one here. For the...
I got to focus. I'm sorry, I don't want to cut you off of your ears, but I got to come up with it.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh.
Same spot we were at in April. You still have that same general area, but now, how do you close off the streets and put in a big grassy area? And this is a water mountain. Everybody will worry about off shots that much. You're also noticed that nothing begins with dark spaces. Now it's not yet.
And you're smoking one?
No.
They go on Twitter on paper. Yeah, exactly. You don't need a dissertation.
Yeah, the longer they'll go on and on.
You get the
truth of that, huh? Oh, man.
Jared wants me to look at his phone.
I don't have one.
He doesn't have his phone. He put it away. So, I'll walk in here. Okay. All right. I think he's running to the other. Yeah, why don't you get here now?
So,
what are we doing now? So we're starting with you. You ask him. You have 2 minutes to respond. Yeah, he has 1 minute.
No, that's okay.
Yeah.
During rebuttal, I have 2 minutes.
Then I have.
Then 2 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And that's.
Yeah.
And then right now, for both of you, because I mean, I didn't know if you had questions, so I want to make sure that there's
exactly.
It's probably going to be more questions for you than for him, so I have to come up with more questions.
I'm much more comfortable with that than I'm thinking.
Now she's
calling.
Yes. If folks want to start making their way in, if folks outside want to start making their way in,
someone texted me and called me and said, "Come over here." I would tell you that too.
That's fine. I think people are doing running commentary, and I'm doing everything I can to not listen. I want to be.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I don't even have anything else open up. I mean,
so that's what, one then?
Yeah.
I kind of like to. I love one. I'm a huge fan. And the surface is incredible. That's the one. Except it's me. That's why I like it, because apples are terrible.
Linux, man, Linux.
Okay.
I would have expected more.
Linux is too, it's too geeky for me. I can't.
I had my kids on Linux until I realized that they don't know how to use a computer.
Exactly.
Nobody uses Linux. All right. So, you're going to start with
All right. Anthony, if you just want to have Dan check outside, see if everyone's in. We're going to get started again. Got some questions here for the facilitated discussion that we'll be having in a bit. First, we're going to do a 10-minute rebuttal from Chris, then a 10-minute rebuttal from Len, then we'll get to your questions and then closing comments. So, Chris.
So, first of all, let me just say, as you guys are, I'm sure, aware, there's no possible way that either of us will be able to fully address everything the other has said in their opening statement. There's no possible way. That having been said, I'm going to try to address some of the things that I think are most important, and then hopefully some of you guys have asked some great questions, and I'll look forward to interacting with those more. First of all, the cross. I think the cross is absolutely critical here. Any view of hell or any view of anything else that makes an orthodox view of the cross impossible is heretical, at least insofar as that's its logical conclusion, even if a person doesn't follow it to its logical conclusion. So this is a really important area. Now, Len literally said that Jesus suffered everything a sinner will in hell. Those were his words. And yet he denied that they will ever, ever, ever die. And yet Scripture consistently emphasizes his death as the punishment he bore on our behalf. Isaiah 53, he was poured out to death. 1 Corinthians 15, he died, was buried, and rose again. Len says that will never, ever, ever, ever happen to the risen lost. Here's what's worse, though. He said that Jesus exhausted the eternal duration of suffering awaiting the lost in the finite duration of his own suffering. which renders his death an arbitrary, unnecessary afterthought. If the penalty was paid, why did he have to go on to die? That's far closer to heresy than anything I've said. But he doesn't follow it to its logical conclusion, and I understand that. Now, he said, in my view, the atonement is incomplete because Jesus died bodily, but his soul lived on, and he didn't cease to exist. Well, firstly, my view isn't that final punishment consists in cessation of existence, but cessation of life, the very thing that Jesus suffered on our behalf. Now, he gave up the psychosomatic, that means body and mind, he gave up the psychosomatic or body and soul, psychosomatic life that he had enjoyed, and final punishment consists in an eternity of being deprived of psychosomatic life. If Jesus' human soul subsisted beyond death, okay, and those of the lost will not, that doesn't change the fact that the punishment he bore on our behalf was precisely the punishment that they will pay, the end of their psychosomatic lives, the end of their life. Now, let appeal to the story of Lazarus and the rich man. Yes, I affirm a view in philosophy of mind which is called physicalism, non-reductive physicalism to be specific. And yes, I think that the story of Lazarus and the rich man is a parable or a folktale of sorts. But here's the thing, that's not at all necessary for a view of conditionalism. I know many conditionalists, even on the Rethinking Hell team, who are dualists who think that souls continue to live on. Physicalism is not required. Irenaeus is a good example of it. But let's say for the sake of argument that the story of Lazarus and the rich man is a literal historical narrative of something that actually happened. Here's the thing, that took place in the intermediate state, in the grave, not final punishment. It specifically calls it Hades, it says that the rich man and Lazarus were buried. What takes place in that scene takes place in the intermediate state. And here's the thing, there's a really good reason why we call it the intermediate state, because it's going to come to an end when death and Hades are emptied. And it is thrown in the lake of fire where death will be destroyed. Now, as for the idea that if death is going to be destroyed, nobody can ever die anymore, that confuses what that means. What it means if death will be destroyed is that there will come a point where nobody will ever, ever, ever die again. If all of mankind is raised and God's enemies are destroyed, and then all who remain, the redeemed, never, ever, ever die again, death will have been obliterated. There will be no more death ever again. Okay? But notice what he said. The everlasting punishment of the lost consists in an eternity of dying. Well, how can you say death has been annihilated and yet people are dying forever? I mean, there's no sense in what he's saying. Now, Lynn also claimed that I was making the same kind of hermeneutical errors that Nicodemus made, and yet I showed you example after example after example after example in Romans 6:23 and in the text leading up to it and afterward that indicate that what Paul is talking about by death there is bodily death. I'm not reading 21st century meanings of death into the text of Scripture. I'm letting Paul speak for himself. And personally, I don't know about you guys, but I'd rather believe in how Paul defines death in Romans 6:23 and Romans 5:12 and 17 and how Jesus defines it in John 3:16 than allow the tradition that has developed over thousands of years to inform what Paul meant. And again, I never said that the punishment, he also said, Lynn said that I define death as cessation of existence. I just don't find me anywhere where I've defined it as such. I define it as cessation of life. He said that 2 Thessalonians 1 says eternal destruction is away from the Lord's presence. That is not the presence. That's not what that text says. It says that they will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction, apa, the Greek preposition meaning either from or away from the presence of the Lord. What that doesn't mean is that they are somehow taken from one place and placed in another where they will be ongoingly ruined forever. What it means is that they will be destroyed from the presence of God. Either that the presence of God itself will be the means by which they are destroyed, or it means that they will be separated from God's presence and they're destroyed and their destruction will be eternal. This doesn't mean eternal ongoing ruination or eternal ongoing suffering. It means that their destruction will be forever. This is a text which is much better support for mine. In fact, in that very text, Paul uses the terminology of flaming fire and vengeance. The only place in the Old Testament where this combination of terms is found is in Isaiah 66:15, I believe it is, it's verse 15, which is a scene in which God's enemies are slain, and that scene ends with their corpses being utterly consumed by fire and by maggots. 2 Thessalonians 1:9 is fully in my camp, not Lynn's. Now, as for John 3:36, the verb meno in Greek, it means to abide, it means to remain, it means to stay or to wait. I'm in my third semester of Greek right now. I'm well familiar with that word. It served for some of the paradigms and some of the morphologies that we're studying. But here's the thing. What is not included in that is any sort of understanding of ongoing, forever, never-ending remaining. Just do a search for how this word is used, Matthew 10:11, and whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it and stay there forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. No, until you depart. Then he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. This is, in, I believe, in the Garden of Gethsemane, or maybe it's, yeah, it's in the Garden of Gethsemane. Even to death. Menno here, remain here, and watch with me. Was Jesus commanding them to remain in the Garden of Gethsemane forever? The verb just means to wait. And in John 3:36, Jesus is saying, or what is being said, is that the wrath of God abides on unbelievers now. It's not. This isn't a future tense. This is a present tense. This is what's happening to them now. We are both fans of James White, although we both take issues with him in certain areas. And James White has often said that I've lost my train of thought. He's often said that the America, for example, is a nation that is currently under the judgment of God now. God's wrath abides on unbelievers and upon those who pervert his law and refuse his gospel now. This text says nothing about whether or not it will continue to abide on them forever into the eschaton. Let's see what else we've got. So he said that wrath cannot burn forever on beings that no longer exist. I generally agree. I don't think that wrath can continue to exist on objects that no longer exist. But again, this text says that wrath abides on unbelievers now. There's no text that says God's wrath will abide forever. In fact, some systematic theologians, understandably, have tried to make an argument from the doctrine of God's simplicity, saying that if God is wrath, that's one of his attributes, and his wrath must be eternal, forgetting the fact that there was no exhibition of wrath, there was no display of wrath prior to creation. God can choose when to show his wrath and when to end it, and if his wrath consumes the enemies of God, then it no longer need be displayed. Now, he also said that, in my view, the lost are propitiating the wrath of God. That's simply untrue. Propitiation does not merely mean to satisfy the wrath of God. It means to divert it. Jesus propitiated for us because he suffered the wrath of God on our behalf, diverting it from us. The wrath of God is not diverted from the lost when they suffer it, when they suffer the full weight of God's wrath and are destroyed. It's not diverted from it. They suffer its full weight. Okay? They're totally destroyed by God's wrath. They don't have an atonement for them. So they suffer the punishment of sin themselves. I've got about a minute and a half. Let's see what else I've got here. So this is important. Len said that the lost don't fear death. This is patently absurd. Atheists will often say they don't, and as Christians, we need not fear death. And yet, if you look at the actions of anybody who's in the face of death, they are all terrified of it. If you guys have ever seen the story played, the movie in which the main character is played by James Franco, 128 Hours, he is a hiker. This is a true story. A hiker goes into the deserts and he's climbing and he gets stuck. And what does he do? Because he doesn't want to die, he cuts his own arm off. And he rappels down the cliffside, literally single-handedly, to make his way to safety so that he can hold on to his life. This is the whole premise of the Saw movies, which are so deplorable in a number of ways. But the point is that the reason those grip us, those of us who watch them, when we watch them as unbelievers, hopefully, the reason they grip us is because we sense what's going on there. They are desperately clinging to their lives, tooth and nail, with everything they possibly can, even willing to do the most abominable evil to hold on to their lives. The idea that what everybody in the world acknowledges to be the biggest fear humans have is death, the idea that that's actually something that the unbelievers are happy about or that they don't care about, flies in the face of all human experience. It just does. And besides, it's not a biblical argument. So I've got about 15 seconds left, and I don't have much more to say, but I do want to say that I am very grateful for my friend Len and the kind of spirit that we've exhibited so far. I think it's fantastic. Thank you for being here as well.
So you're admitting that you watched the Saw?
I said when I was an unbeliever.
Right. Which we... I don't know how when those movies even came out.
All right.
My time starts...
You said
no. Okay. So I just want to touch on Menno again here, because Chris made an error here that I want to point out. Again, there's a semantic range to Greek words. The word Menno in reference to a place means to sojourn or tarry and not to depart. And those are the verses that Chris appealed to. So he's trying to shift the goalpost. So, he's trying to make it look like I'm saying something that I'm not. I was specifically referring to, in John 3:36, it's in reference to a time or in reference to a state or condition, which means specifically, again, to continue to be, not to perish, to last or endure, and the persons to survive and live. And in reference to a state or condition, to remain as one and not to become one or different. So the verses that he appealed to have absolutely no bearing on the argument whatsoever. He completely shifted the goalposts there. I think it's important to talk about what it means to be made in the image of God, and I think that that is one of the things that that I think the condition for the, I guess if you wanted to call it innate immortality, that to be made in the image of God means that we are a unitary being of a material body created of natural order and soul that, and a soul that was breathed into us by God. Go back to Genesis 2:7, which says, "Then the Lord formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being." Now, being in the Hebrew here is the word nefesh, which can also mean soul. And I think the King James actually renders that he became a living soul. You know, so what this means is that we became a living soul. We weren't given a living soul. It's our natural condition, okay? Death is not a natural thing for mankind. We were created to live eternally. I think it's important to point out that some other things argued by Chris and conditional immortalists, that God did not create man immortal, but rather dependent with the potential of living forever. But that goes against, again, what we see with the account of Genesis and in creation, that the Lord God said, "Behold, the man has become like one of us to know good and evil." This is after he took of the tree. Now, forfeiture to the tree of life proves in the fall that they lost their immortality. I think that that's a logical fallacy. If you argue that they were not endowed with immortality pre-fall, then they couldn't lose it post-fall. Either they have immortality or they don't. So to even call it conditional immortality is kind of a logical fallacy in and of itself. So man became a living soul, and that becoming that living soul made in the image of God, we are thus immortal. And the soul coming from God himself, who is immortal, and also being made in the image of God means that we represent God on earth. We are the representation of God on earth. This nefesh that we have, it's also used, I think it's notable to state that the word nefesh is also used when it speaks of animals that are alive, but never when they're dead, which is contrary to how the Old Testament will say, like, you shouldn't go near a corpse. That word there can also be nefesh in many cases. So man is separate than animals. Being created in the image of God, we're unique, and we are indeed immortal, as God is. And again, Chris wants to apply this hermeneutic that says immortality only means length of time, but not quality also. It's also important to note that the image of God is never taken away from us after the fall. In Genesis 5:1-5, it says, "This is the book of the genealogy of Adam. And the day that God created Adam, he made him in his likeness. He created them male and female and blessed them and called them mankind in the day that they were created. And Adam lived 130 years, and he begot a son in his own likeness and his image and named him Seth. And after he begot Seth, the days of Adam were 800, etc., etc." So we see Adam created in God's image, and the progeny continues. We are, just like the scripture says, we are either all in Adam or in Christ. And so we're talking in both states, there is an immortality, but in Christ that immortality is fully realized. So for example, when Adam sinned, in a sense, he took on the image of Satan. And we see Jesus telling the Pharisees, "You're sons of the devil." Scripture says that we are children of wrath by nature in Ephesians 2, and I believe Colossians 1 as well. We see in Genesis 9:6, "Whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed. For in the image of God he made man." So the image of God continues. It's not stripped. The nefesh continues to be with us after the fall. Acts 17:28, "For in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets said, for we are also his offspring." So the image of God was never stripped from us. In fact, I think it's fair to summarize that by saying that when we look at the garden, we can surmise that the immortality, that we are created immortal, and that Adam was created immortal, because he told Adam, "In the day that he eats the fruit, he shall die." So that the natural condition of him was not to die. The condition was that he would die if he ate of the fruit. So his natural state was to continue living. Okay? So, and I think that that, again, is an argument for the immortality not being conditional, but being innate. So I want to go to Isaiah 66, which Chris likes to appeal to, verses 22 through 24. For as the new heavens and the new earth which I make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your descendants and your name remain. And it shall come to pass that from new moon to new moon, and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship me, says the Lord. And they shall go forth and look upon the corpses of men who have transgressed against me, for their worm does not die, and their fire is not quenched. They shall be in abhorrence to all flesh. New moon and new moon, Sabbath to Sabbath. These are hyperbole to show that this is an ongoing parallel of worship in the new heavens and the new earth. The fire is not quenched and the worm does not die. So this is a statement of ongoing judgment. There's a parallelism, Sabbath to Sabbath, new moon to new moon. Now, Chris says that he never said that he believes that there's a cessation of existence. And yet he tells you that the fire is ultimately going to consume them. So what remains? What remains if they're consumed? Again, we're going to have corpses there that are just lying around. Again, Chris is ignoring the prophetic nature of Isaiah 66, which Jesus expounds upon and teaches us more about this prophecy about the final judgment. This is a prophecy here. But Chris ignores Jesus' exposition of this prophecy, where he makes it clear that this is a picture of ongoing eternal torment for the impenitent sinner. Of course, that's Matthew 25, 41 through 46. We also see that in Revelation 20, verses 10 through 14. Another thing that I wanted to point out here with regard to the beast and the false prophet, again, they're men like us. They are men exactly like us. And it says that they continue to be tormented day and night forever and ever. Okay, you see it. There's a 1,000-year period from when they're first cast in there and then the devil cast in there. Now, whatever your position on eschatology is, whether that 1,000 years is literal or not, it's a long time. How long does a fire take to consume a human body? I mean, is this like a really slow, unquenchable fire? Like really slow? But again, Chris said that it's a consuming fire, but yet they don't cease to exist. There's a logical problem here, a real logical problem that we haven't seen explained. He just says, I never said that. Well, you're implying it. When you're saying that the body is consumed, you're implying that it doesn't, when I consume an apple, guess what? It exists in my stomach, but not for very much longer. Okay, it goes away. Eventually that apple does not exist. Again, one of the things that I want to point out here is that Chris says that the word punish, is a noun. Now, there isn't a single resource I could find, and again, I'm no Greek scholar, but I couldn't find a single resource that says that the word kalazo is anything other than a verb. Every resource that I looked at states that it's a verb. That means chastisement or retributive punishment, not annihilation. Acts 4:21 says, when they had further threatened him, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people, for all were praising God for what had happened. So they were looking, again, they were looking for a way to punish them. Exact same word. Were they looking to annihilate them out of existence? Maybe, I guess. You maybe could make the case for that. I didn't get to the meeting.
The clock is right there. Don't
I'm such a rookie.
Rookie. All right, we're gonna take questions that we got from you guys. I will say this, where I'm going to be asking these questions as quick as I can. There's some that I could not read the handwriting, so if you wrote the question, you recognize it's your question, and I read it wrong, just correct me so that I know, so I can get it right. It's going to be a two-minute. First one will be go to you, Chris. You got 2 minutes, and then you have a one-minute rebuttal. So, for you, Chris, you quoted Anacius and Irenaeus in defense of your position, yet in chapter 16 of Anacius' letter to Ephesians and against heresies book,
and chapter 10, they mention hell as being an everlasting fire. Can you list any fathers who agree with you?
So I'll answer that question. I'll answer that question, but one thing I want to point out is that the word in Matthew 25, 46 is not the verb kalazo, it's the noun kolossus. That having been said, so one of the problems that traditionalists often, one of the things they often do is they read language that is just a repetition of biblical language in the early church fathers and say, oh, look, clearly they're traditionalists because they use the phrase eternal fire or eternal punishment or quenchable fire. But that is to beg the question. That's a logical fallacy. The question that we're debating is what that terminology means. So when Irenaeus says eternal fire or when Ignatius says it or whatever, the question is, what do they mean by that? And Len thinks one thing and I think another. It doesn't work to simply appeal to that phrase in the church father as evidence that they were a traditionalist, because I contend that that terminology is my view. After all, Jude uses that language and to refer to the fire that came down from heaven and slew the inhabitants of Sodom and Gomorrah, the parallel in 2 Peter 2, saying that they were reduced to ashes as an example of final punishment. Now, as for the church fathers, what I'd encourage you to do is to go look in the Rethinking Hell YouTube channel for a video done by Glenn Peoples called Church Fathers Who Were Conditionalists, and you'll see several of them. When the early church fathers, prior to Augustine, went beyond biblical language, when they used language of their own making, that language is unmistakably, at least in many of their cases, conditionless. Irenaeus said that whereas the saved are granted length of days and continuance forever and ever, the lost justly deprive themselves of those things. And he compares those to the sun, the moon, and the stars as continuing to exist because God wills that they do. You can't say that he's talking about a quality of length of days forever and ever, because his whole point is that look at the sun, the moon, and the stars. They're still there. And he can do that with the saved, but he won't with the lost. Clement, Ignatius, Athanasius even, I would argue, who said that mankind was on its way back to non-being from whence they had come. There, I just used a preposition from, and I didn't need to. People on Facebook will know that joke. But anyway, there are plenty of them. Just go to Rethinking Hell YouTube channel and look for Church Fathers, and you'll find a video.
Okay. Yeah, Mormons have, like, lost doctrine, too, that they just discovered in the last couple of hundred years, right? I mean, that's kind of what that sounds like to me, is that they believed all of these things that you know, we're just reading them wrong. I disagree. And again, I'm no church historian, but I'll say that my appeal is primarily to scripture here, and Chris calls me a traditionalist. So I want you to notice who's appealed to tradition in this sense.
Okay, for Len, couple of them came in with the same question. So dealing with the word minnow.
Yes.
So if you stop abiding in the word, do you cease to abide in Christ? Does minnow always mean forever or conditional?
No, it does not always mean forever. But in reference to time and in reference to a state or condition, it does. In reference to a place, it does not.
Oh, okay, sure. So I'm not familiar with the lexicon or the grammar that Len is appealing to. Oftentimes traditionalists have a tendency, and I'm not saying Len is doing this, but oftentimes they appeal to old 100-year or more year old lexicons whose meanings are outdated, and we've since done research to find out that they are wrong. People used to think that New Testament Greek was a special Holy Spirit language Greek, but we've learned that it's just the regular ordinary Koine that was spoken in the day. And the word meno just does not have that meaning in any of its states. It does not imply forever. If you look it up in any more recent lexicon based on more recent research, you just will not find that distinction. And furthermore, he said that the distinction in this case has to do with time, but it says wrath abides on the person in this present right here.
Right, a state or condition.
I'm sorry, this was my time again, sorry. So the reality is there just is no lexical basis for claiming that in some cases it means forever innately, and other times it does not. The Greek word just means to remain, that's all.
If he has a minute left, can I take that minute?
No. I only get 1 minute.
Oh, he only gets 1 minute. You didn't use your full two, okay. So I'll leave it to you. Do you want to give him another minute?
You can research it. I get another minute?
Yeah, I said I don't mind.
Oh, okay, so again, when you look at the context of what he is saying, what I say absolutely matches. When you're looking at a state or condition, which wrath is a state or condition, is it not? Wrath isn't a place.
Wrath is an attribute when it's displayed. It's a expression. It's not a time or a.
It's a state or condition.
No, wrath is an expression of fury.
Okay, and what is fury?
It's a person's emotion. I'm sorry, I'm picking up his
minute. No, I'm fine with that. Okay. I think you're just ignoring the obvious here.
I don't know if I'm ignoring it, it's because it's not obvious to me.
Well, okay, that's fair enough. But I mean, again, in reference to a state or condition, wrath being that state or condition, again, if you are under wrath, you're under wrath, you're not under a place, you are in a state or condition.
Is that a question?
Like if you're in a coma, you're not in a place called coma, you're in a state called coma.
Okay, thanks. All right, for Chris, why is eternal fire sent to destroy, it looks like Sig. Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay. Why is eternal fire sent to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah and not still burning?
So that's an excellent question. One possibility is that the fire that is eternal is in fact God himself. God is eternal. God is called the consuming fire. He is the quintessential eternal fire, and it's the fire from heaven which came down and destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Jude explicitly states that eternal fire, it doesn't refer to any sort of burning in the intermediate state. In fact, the verb translated exhibited or something like that in Jude 7, what it means is to be laid out in plain sight. The inhabitants of Hades are not laid out in plain sight anywhere either in scripture or in the natural world. What is laid out in plain sight is the record of their historical destruction by fire from heaven, which is exactly what's said in 2 Peter, the parallel traditionally to Jude, in which their reduction to ashes is said to be an example of final punishment. So eternal fire is fire because it's God's fire. It's the fire of God himself as opposed to natural fire which burns out. But here's the thing. Let's argue for a moment. Let's say for the sake of argument that by saying that the fire is eternal, it will literally burn on forever. You know what's in the eternal fire of the lake of fire in Revelation before the beast and the false prophet are thrown into it? Anybody want to take a guess? Nothing. So the eternal fire of hell, if it is in fact ongoingly, eternally burning fire, doesn't need anything in there to fuel its fire. That's a canard that traditionalists like to cite as evidence that eternal fire means people are burning in it forever. I don't see any evidence here from the language of eternal fire. If anything, Len mentioned Matthew 18:8. There, Jesus uses eternal fire as a parallel to Gehenna. Gehenna is the Old Testament Valley of the Sons of Hinnom, which Jeremiah 7:31 and 32:33 says would become the Valley of Slaughter, where the dead bodies of God's slain enemies would be consumed by scavenging beasts and birds, and nobody would be able to frighten them away. The Gehenna that is parallel to the eternal fire, Matthew 18:8, is not ongoing, forever burning fire. And even if it were, it wouldn't need anything to fuel it. But rather, it's a reference to the Gehenna, which is a place where God's enemies would be destroyed.
Okay,
man, like fast.
Holy cow.
I have to. I only have 2 minutes.
We're done already.
Len, there was a question here. If Jude mentions eternal fire, why is Sodom not still burning? So with that, I'm going to give you 2 minutes so we don't have to do the rebuttal to the same question.
Okay. Well, let me just point out here that Jude 7. Again, it's an exposition of something that happened in the Old Testament that brings us clarity. Jude 7, and I'm reading from the New King James here, says, as Sodom and Gomorrah, the cities around them in a similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. So what we see here is Jude pointing out something that happened in the past, right? That they did these things. They gave themselves over to sexual immorality. They went after strange flesh. And now they are set forth an example suffering. They are now suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now this eternal fire, again, it can only mean eternal. And I'm going to appeal to the article noun, article adjective construction in Matthew 18:8. In Matthew 18:8 and Matthew 25:41. Now this construction, basically what it's saying is that it is the fire, the eternal one. So that's literally how that reads. It doesn't read literally eternal fire, it reads fire, the eternal one. So it's setting itself apart specifically from any other kind of fire. It's like saying, well, which house is yours? It's the yellow one. Then it's modifying it. So I'm telling you something specific about it to set my house apart from every other house. So this is an eternal fire. And these, again, they're semantically linked. They're semantically linked with Gehenna, unquenchable fire, and eternal punishment, all mentioned and Matthew and Mark also in Revelation. And again, I want to point out here that Chris is, he's again ignoring the hermeneutic. He appeals to the Old Testament, and he's not going to the clear revelation that's expounding further upon those Old Testament passages that we see in the New Testament.
Time. All right, so there's next question.
How do you do that?
I'm like, what practice?
I should have done that.
In New Jersey, we do this normally. Yeah. I have to slip. Okay, so this next question is a question that's very similar for each of you. So again, I'll give each of you 2 minutes. And I'll read each from Chris to you. Does Chris think it would be unjust if hell was eternal? If so, what makes the doctrine of propitiation,
retribution,
any different? And then the question that got asked, I guess, to you is, if God does punish sinners for eternity, would it be right for him to do it?
So who's first?
So you go first.
All right. First of all, I just want to point out that the word suffering in Jude 7 is a participle. It's not a regular verb. And in participles, the tense of the verb does not mean absolute time. Present does not mean now in a participle. It's relative to the main verb that controls the sentence. And the sentence in this case is exhibited, laid out in plain sight. The only place where the inhabitants of Sodom and Gomorrah are laid out in plain sight anywhere is in the historical record in the book of Genesis, where they are destroyed by this fire. So the suffering, the punishment of eternal fire, that's a reference, relative time is the way participles communicate time in their tenses, to what happened then in the historical record. We see the same thing in Josephus. He uses a very similar construction where he refers to people now as examples now who are actually recorded in the historical record of Scripture. That's how they serve as an example, by what happened to them in the past. Now, as to the question, do I think it would be just for hell to be eternal, for God to punitively keep people alive forever in torment as punishment for their sins? Yes, God would be just to do that. But it's not what Scripture teaches. And as far as reprobation goes, this is sometimes traditionalists, particularly us Calvinist ones, will think
there's more than one of you.
There are a few more than one of us. We'll say that what we have to believe is that eventually people stop sinning in order for the punishment to end. But that's a mistake. As you'll note, I haven't ever said that the punishment is the torment leading up to their demise. I've said the punishment is their demise. People can be, imagine somebody being dragged down the Green Mile on the way to the electric chair. They can sit there and they could stab the guards on the way or whatever, all the way leading up to the moment where they're strapped into that electric chair and they breathe their last. They don't need to continue to be punished. Their death is the punishment that accounts for all the sins, including any sins they commit as they breathe their last breath. So reprobation does not challenge my view, and God will be perfectly just if that were what he said was the punishment for sin.
Perfect timing again. Another movie reference.
I watch a lot of movies, or have watched a lot of movies.
So here's the side one. Can a Christian watch The Living Dead?
I watch The Walking Dead. So if that disqualifies me as a Christian.
But the question is, are they dead?
Well, I was told by one traditionalist that the lost in hell will be like zombies. Thankfully, you don't make that.
Okay, what was my question?
Your question was, if God does punish sinners for eternity, would it be right for him to do it?
Yeah, absolutely. It's what we deserve. It's what each and every single one of us deserve. I think that's what the atonement is Christ taking on our punishment upon himself so that we can have his righteousness. The opposite of life is not death. It's wrath. And part of that wrath is death. But, you know, you see this in John 3:36 and Ephesians 2:1. You know, you who are dead in your trespasses and sins. So is God unjust? No. I mean, isn't this what Paul asks in Romans 9? Is there injustice with God? May it never be. And he makes a comparison of the pot and the clay, you know, that you're the potter and the clay, God being the potter. I didn't bring my silly putty with me, but Paul makes the comparison of a potter making pottery, and that's us. We're pottery, and some of those are pots for honorable use and some for dishonorable use, you know. And Paul asks, who are you to reply to God? So is God just? Yeah, there's no injustice with God, none.
Amen.
Okay, so the next question. Pull it up.
Sorry. How much more time do we have here?
5 minutes.
Okay.
So maybe one question each?
Yeah.
We have one mark here again.
So we get, okay, yeah. So, question for Chris. If you receive this, if you receive it in time, so I texted this one. So, are you aware that there are people with conditionalism camps that reject penal substitutional atonement but affirm the substitutionary atonement? Also, do you affirm evangelical universalism as an orthodox view of atonement if Christ took the punishment for his for his death, which the wicked who are not saved experience at least once before the day of judgment?
So the first question was, can I read that?
Yeah,
thank you for restarting my time, because there were two questions there asked, not one. Oh, so number one, penal, yes, there are conditionalists who reject penal substitutionary atonement but affirm substitutionary atonement. In fact, that's a language I used in my opening statement, because I want to recognize that, yes, conditionalists, not all conditionalists, and not even all, you know, not even all Christians affirm penal substitution. I do. I think that what Jesus bore on our behalf was punitive. It was a punishment. It was God's wrath. It was an expression of God's wrath that killed him. But not all conditionalists do, and not all Christians do. Some will just say that he suffered what was coming to us. It may not have been punitive, and that what he suffered for us was death, and therefore we will not die. Whether somebody affirms penal substitution or just substitution, it's perfectly consistent with conditionalism. Now, as for the second question, do I affirm that evangelical universalists are within the boundaries of Christianity? I'm not sure what relevance this has in the debate, and frankly, I think it's an attempt to make me look bad in this debate, but I'm honest, I'm going to answer it. I think that there are at least two kinds of universalisms. There are two kinds of universalisms. One is the one that says it doesn't matter what you believe. Everybody goes to hell no matter what they believe. And those kinds of universalists are heretics. They are not Christians. Okay? Scriptures make it absolutely abundantly clear that the only way to salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ. But that isn't all universalists. There are universalists who think that everybody will eventually be saved, but only after they finally put their faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus died, in their view, for everybody. They share an Arminian view of universal unlimited atonement. I don't share that view, but they do. And so they believe that Jesus suffered that penalty on everybody's behalf, and that eventually, therefore, everybody will be saved. But in the same way that we are not saved in the here and now until we place our trust in that atoning work on our behalf, so too will the lost in hell after their resurrection continue to persist in misery until they also place their faith in Jesus Christ and are thereby saved. I cannot identify any heresy in that view. If you can, please tell me, because I don't like having to affirm that these universalists are Christians, but I can't see any logical way to do otherwise.
Time, and I think, just for the record, I think you said that there's some universalists that think that all go to hell. I think.
Well, I mean, they all go to heaven regardless of what they believe. And
so I just wanted to. For people that don't realize, when you're speaking fast and you have a lot on your mind, that. So
do I get a minute for
you?
A
minute.
Okay. So I think that one of the things that one of the problems that I have with conditional immortality is that it's usually a symptom of bigger problems theologically. Not with Chris. Chris and I have had a lot of conversations, and like I said, we agree on almost every other point of doctrine. So either you're lying to me, but I think Chris has to admit that he's a bit of a black swan in his movement. In other words, there aren't a lot of Calvinists in the movement. There's a lot more aberrant theology. And I know it bothers Chris that there are, for example, colleges who will not allow you on staff if you're an annihilationist. And I think that's wise. I think that's wise because of the implications I was speaking of in my opening statement in regards to the cross and propitiation. I think that anyone who, if you have someone in your church who holds this position, I would personally put them on a bit of a theological quarantine.
Time. Okay. Question for you. John 17:3. Give you time to look that one up.
By the way, Logos is incredible software.
Amen. We can agree.
No one's giving me their password.
You have Logos 7 now?
No, I have not gotten Logos 7. All right, so you want to ask
it. I bet you don't have more books than
me. I've got the portfolio edition. Sorry, go ahead. So what about John 17:3?
John 17:3, he's already pulling up the answer, good. So the question is, John 17:3 defines eternal life
as knowing Christ, why would you why basically would you say that?
So for those who don't have an encyclopedic memory of scripture, here's what John 17:3 says, and this is Jesus speaking. This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. Clearly what Jesus is doing is defining eternal life as knowing Christ, right? No, that's not correct. That is not how the copula, the Greek verb eimi, is always used in scripture. It's not even the most obvious way it's used in scripture. So for example, Jesus also says in John 12:49-50 that the Father who sent me has himself given a commandment, and I know that his commandment is eternal life. Oh, wait, so is eternal life a commandment? Jesus' use of the copula, the verb eimi, in both passages translated is, does not literally equate eternal life with the Father's commandment, and neither must it equate eternal life with knowing God and his Son. The copula often means something other than is identical to. When a parent exasperatingly says to her children, you kids will be the death of me, she doesn't mean her children will become identical to her demise, but that they will cause or bring it about. And so here in John 12:49-50, explains D.A. Carson, God's command leads to eternal life. Similarly, in John 6:63, Jesus uses the copula to say, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Commenting on this text, Leon Morris writes that Jesus' words are creative utterances. They not only tell of life, they bring life. Pointing to John 5:24, in which Jesus says, whoever hears my word and believes in me, who sent me, has eternal life. So likewise, faith in and communion with the Father and the Son bring about eternal life. After all, elsewhere Jesus says, everyone who believes in me shall never die. John Calvin thus explains John 17:3, saying, Jesus now describes how he gives life. It is when he enlightens the elect in the true knowledge of God. He is not here speaking about the enjoyment of life that we hope for, but only about how people obtain it. So that's the answer. Jesus is not defining eternal life. He's telling you how to get it.
1 minute response. Thank you, Nicodemus. I want to point out again in my opening statement that, as I said, Chris's view causes you to pull the shade over the light of the clear reading of Scripture. As I look at the meaning of this word, it means of the absolute fullness of life, both essential and ethical, which belong to God, and through him both the hypostatic logos and the Christ to whom the logos put on the human nature. I agree. Jesus is defining what eternal life is. But Chris wants you to ignore what Jesus is actually saying and say, no, this is in reference to a period of time. And that's been my argument this whole debate, is that life is not just, I mean, it certainly is about a period of time, but it is also about equality. And I think that this is what Jesus is saying. This is what the very meaning of the word life in this verse says. So.
Okay, last question to you, Len. Does eternal fire have to be a literal meaning, or as you stated, could it have parabolic language?
No, well, not in the cases of Matthew 25:46 and Matthew 18:8, where it uses that construction I was talking about earlier, the noun adjective noun construction, where in the Greek it's literally saying the fire, the eternal one. The fire, the unquenchable one, it is separating itself and identifying itself as something completely and utterly different than any other kind of fire.
Still a minute and a half.
That, I don't, I mean, I could sing.
I'm not going to give you the time back this time.
All right. He can have my minute and a half.
Well, let's see if I need it. So the construction he's referring to is what's called the second attributive position. It's when you have an article and then the noun and then the article and the adjective. And it does add a slight emphasis that what's called the first attributive position would not, which is where the adjectives falls between the article and the noun. But that emphasis does not preclude the very kind of meaning that Len just said, which is that it sets this apart as being different from ordinary fire. Okay, it doesn't necessarily mean that it actually is burning forever. That could be, although as I said, God is the quintessential consuming fire, and he does burn forever. And think about it, the fire that came down from heaven and destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, what was it consuming while it was on its way down to earth? I mean, we could pretend we know the answer to that question, but we don't. The reality is it was burning before anything it was intended to consume were actually touched by that fire. There's no need for this fire to be a fire that continually ongoingly burns the objects of God's wrath, because it was burning before there were any objects of God's wrath in it.
Time. You really nailed that. The time.
All right, 5 minute closing. So give me a sec, and whenever you're ready.
All right. If by this point in the debate, neither participant has become convinced of his opponent's view, he will now typically offer a brief summary of his positive case for his view and of his rebuttal to that of his opponent. To those of you who might have hoped that I would be convinced by my friend Len's case, I'm sorry to let you down. I will, however, ever so briefly offer that summary now. When sound hermeneutical principles are applied to the task of exegesis, the Word of God teaches that, number one, the telos of the gospel is to save lives altogether, rescuing them from the clutches of death. Two, immortality, everlasting life, is a gift God will grant only to the redeemed. Three, the nature of final punishment awaiting the resurrected lost in hell is death and destruction, not life and misery. When it comes to the case for the historically dominant view, with virtually no exception, every text typically cited in support of eternal torment proves upon closer examination to be better support for my view, as I demonstrated in my opening, and none of the rebuttals held up under scrutiny. However, I am not so foolish as to think that many of you will have been convinced and will have changed your mind in the course of a mere single afternoon. In fact, I caution you not to do so. If you found my case and my answers to Len's case even remotely compelling, great, it should have. But let it serve as a springboard for further, deeper study before you change your mind. There's a reason the doctrine of eternal torment is often called traditionalism. It's not because people are committed to tradition, it's because it's been by far the dominant Christian view of hell for some 1,500 years. The brilliance and the piety of the many upon whose shoulders we stand demand that you take your time and exercise care on this topic. But in the meantime, what you should have been persuaded of, if you didn't think it already, is that a truly Bible-believing, conservative, born-again, evangelical Christian committed to the authority of the inerrant Scripture can in good conscience hold to my view, convinced the Bible teaches it. We conditionalists ought not to be dismissed or rebuked as heretics simply because our view of hell is superficially similar to that of Jehovah's Witnesses, any more than you ought to be dismissed or rebuked as heretics simply because your doctrine of eternal torment is taught by Muslims, Mormons, Appalachian snake wranglers, and the Westboro Baptist Church. Neither should we be dismissed as liberals any more than you, who have probably departed from the literal flames view of most of the Christians who came before you. Now, I believe passionately in what Philip Schaff once called the watchword of Christian peacemakers, a phrase often mistakenly attributed to Augustine. In essentials, unity. In non-essentials, liberty. In all things, charity. And there are indeed essentials, the rejection of which justifies division, the Trinity, the deity of Christ, his final return to bodily raise the dead, raise and judge the dead, and others. But too often, we Christians elevate secondary non-essential doctrines to this level, virtually anathematizing anyone who does not share our view of the Spirit's gifts, or of God's sovereignty, or on the nature of hell. And I am convinced that this division grieves the heart of the Lord, and it stymies the Church's role in God's mission to the world. Respected traditionalist voices of reason have said conditionalism is not heresy, and that its advocates are not heretics for believing it, including Drs. Michael Brown and James White, the latter's recent dispute with present company here notwithstanding. Sadly, despite their voices and those of many others, many both lay and learned Christian traditionalists treat us conditionalists as heretics. When they're not assuring us of the fiery fate that awaits us, they're nevertheless often excluding us from fellowship and ministry with them. Many churches won't accept us as members and teachers. Many seminaries won't hire us as professors or even admit us as students. Many ministries will not employ us or allow us to volunteer and will fire or force to resign those who become convinced of the view. Brothers and sisters, this has got to be remedied. We should be working together upon the basis of our shared faith in the person and work of Jesus Christ, God incarnate, to edify the body and save the lost who so desperately need him, whatever the nature of the fate that awaits them if they refuse him. And Jesus says in John 13, 34-35, that those lost that we're so desperate to reach will know that we are his disciples if we love one another. I pray then that this debate between my friend Len and me will have matched or exceeded those of Drs. Brown and White in modeling how brothers and sisters in Christ can and should disagree with one another in charity and love on important but secondary doctrines. And I pray deeply that it will inspire all of you, both here locally and those watching from abroad, to do likewise. Thank you.
All right, I'm really humbled to be up here because Chris is really one of the most loving guys that I know. He's been extremely gracious. He has been an open book to me, sharing everything he believes because he knows how important. I wanted to represent his position accurately. I hope I did that today. I, on the other hand, kept everything. I kept all my cards hidden from Chris while he had basically his cards laid flat out on the table. He's got a podcast I could examine, and I listened to every episode. I read his books, and I agree, Chris is not a heretic. But again, conditional immortality is a position that is often a symptom of deeper theological issues. And I think that people who hold to the position need to be examined closely before they're allowed to be put in positions of teaching. And I think that's reasonable. I think it's reasonable that ministries are allowed to be Bereans when it comes to looking at any doctrinal position, to examine it against the scriptures. And I think that places like Boyce College, for example, where Dr. Albert Mohler, where he's the president and he doesn't allow conditionalists on staff, maybe he sees the implications of this that I do and that many others have, is the implications that this has on the doctrine of propitiation and penal substitutionary atonement. Whatever you think about the case Chris made today or not, he had to make the case because he knows that it's out there. And he knows that it's something that needs to be overcome. And if he doesn't do his job in convincing people who are in those positions, then it doesn't become their responsibility to just accept his position without being Bereans about it. So, but again, I think we should do that with any theological position of what people that we disagree with, you know. In regards to my argument specifically, I'm going to kind of restate my case for you here. Again, God's abiding wrath is very important in John 3:36 because the wrath for it to abide means something to abide upon. Again, Chris says that there is no cessation of existence, but again, he restates that the fire does ultimately consume. Well, if it ultimately consumes, that strongly suggests a cessation of existence. When he tried to demonstrate that Menno has other semantic meanings, I agree with that. He just used them outside of what wrath means, a state or condition, and he used it to apply to a place. So I believe he failed in answering that objection. What was my other argument again? Oh, propitiation. Propitiation. So on the doctrine of propitiation, again, God's abiding wrath being removed from the sinner by virtue of his own consummation being consumed or his own cessation of existence, again, that logically makes man the propitiation, or the sinner specifically the propitiation for their own sin. Again, scripture says Christ alone is the propitiation for sin. He alone, nothing else can propitiate the wrath of God except for Jesus Christ. So to believe that God's wrath would continue to burn against something that's been consumed but not consumed out of existence, it makes God, again, I'll remind you of, I'm sorry, train left the station. It just makes God unreasonable that I want to say Tyndale, but I know that isn't it, who has dug up 44 years, Wycliffe, thank you, dug up 44 years after the Roman Catholic Church executed him for heresy, dug up his bones and threw him into the river. And again, on the cross, Christ was never annihilated. He was never ultimately consumed out of existence, although Chris says that isn't what he believes. Again, you decide for yourselves if he's being consistent in that. Then again, logically, the cross is ineffectual for them because the atonement is incomplete. And again, the implication here on those who hate God, they have a false gospel. They have a false gospel that they will be spared the wrath of God. Being spared the wrath of God for any amount of time is good news. So that's my argument. I thank you all for coming here. Some of you came a long ways. I appreciate it. Chris, thanks for jumping on a plane to talk to me. I'm sure the conversation will continue. BibleThumpingWingNut.com, RethinkingHell.com.
Thank you. So with that, we conclude the debate. Again, I would like to thank both Len and Chris.
Len already gave away the podcast names. You know, just so you understand, Chris is an experienced debater, as was displayed. Len, that please is your very first formal debate.
You don't have to make excuses.
I'm not making excuses. You know, but I am saying that it does take both of these men for Len to be able to take on an experienced debater is a tall order. For Chris to come into an area, into a conference where he knows many disagree with him, is a tall order. I have respect for both of these men. With that, my challenge to you again, as I did in the beginning, and as some came in later, the debate that we had before the conference so that conversation could continue, but not so that debate would continue. If you would like to debate Len, if you think Chris didn't do a good enough job, you're more than welcome to come on to Bible Thumping Wingnut, and he will have you on and you can continue that. If you feel that Len didn't do a good enough job, this is not the place to debate Chris. You come on to the Rethinking Health podcast. He said he'll be happy to have you on, and you can continue that debate. But this is not for them. If you have clarifying things that you'd like to discuss with either one of them, this conference is about fellowship. We do not want the fellowship ruined by people trying to argue a point of view. There's a different time and place for that. Both men have opened themselves up to that at a different time, different place. But if there's things that have gotten you thinking, if you want a further explanation, that would be fine. Now, what we're going to do is take a 45-minute break for dinner. There are a